This is a talk called Statically Prevent 404s. My name is Gary Bernhardt. Let's begin by looking at a very hastily drawn diagram of what your web applications look like. We'll ignore this for a second. You have some routes defined with patterns with the familiar syntax, the colon params syntax, and you've got surely links, A tags, and other kinds of path references. But in many, probably most applications, these two are kind of live in separate worlds. There's nothing tying them together and ensuring that your links actually link to things that are really routed somewhere. And so what we're going to do in this talk is see and then actually build from scratch a system that binds the two together, a system for formally defining what paths are in the system. We then just throw those right into the router, totally trivial transformation there. And when we link to those, they're going to ensure that we actually have provided the required params and that the link actually exists. Now, all of that was pretty abstract, so let me eradicate all this gruesome analog stuff and do the thing we came to do, which is look at a computer screen. So this is the paths module of execute program, and you can see that it's just exporting a bunch of names, each of which comes from calling this path function on a pattern. All looks very sort of innocuous and normal. Now, before we see how any of this works and what it's doing, let me show you this lesson path in action. One of the places where we link that is on the review page. This is our TypeScript course, which will interactively teach you TypeScript. We have a whole bunch of lessons. Then later you get reviews that review the things you learned in lessons. And the thing I want to show you here is not this particular code example, but if I finish it, this little line at the bottom here contains a link to the corresponding lesson. And if we open that, there it is. Now we want to make sure that this link works. And if we change the structure of a lesson path, we want to make sure that this doesn't turn into a 404. So we're going to use this little thing, this unobtrusive link that would be easy to forget about when updating. We're going to use this as our motivating example. So going back to the definition of that path, suppose that we want to add, for some reason, some new param here. Maybe we version our lessons, and so we have a version there. If I write that change out, we are immediately going to get a whole bunch of type errors. There were no type errors before. Now there are. There's one in the back end, and there are seven in the front end. And these are the eight places in the system that are linking to a lesson page. And if we look at the message, argument of type courseId lessonId is not assignable to parameter of type courseId lessonId version. So we have a whole bunch of places where we're giving these params, but they're no longer the correct params, and all of those are type errors. And of course, likewise, if we just delete that path, we're going to get type errors, because now the thing that is being, well, Webpack is also mad about that, but the thing that's being imported doesn't even exist anymore, so of course that's a type error. Now let's dig in and look at how we actually use these paths in the router and how we use them when we're linking. The router is actually the simpler case. These paths are, they're actually functions, but they also have properties. And one of the properties on our lesson path is going to be the pattern, which is just a normal Rails slash Express style pattern that you can throw right into React Router as we are here. React Router has no idea that any of this is happening, but it still works just fine. The other side we want to look at is the actual component for this little line here. And this link right here is this A tag. Now it's red right now because we broke it by adding that version. Let's fix it. And the language server is going to take a moment to notice that. The paths module is imported by everything. So whenever we change it, especially for some reason in Vim, the language server takes a while to actually figure it out. I think it'll fix it eventually. Anyway, maybe I'll just kill it and restart it. So we're linking to the path by just calling that function, and the function is what we got by defining the path. So this gives us a function, we call it over here with the corresponding parameters, it's really simple, and we get out an actual path that is the link that we clicked earlier. So that is how we define paths. They're trivial to use in the router, there's basically no extra complexity there. And linking to them, I mean, maybe this is a little more complex than using a template string literal or something, but it's not that much more complex. So how does this all work? that's the interesting question for TSConf. And so let's just build the whole thing, or at least the types, from scratch. We're not going to build the runtime code because that's normal JavaScript stuff. It's less interesting. We'll begin with, we definitely want that path function. And it's going to take a pattern. And the pattern is going to have a type that is some kind of literal string type that is the actual pattern we typed in. So pattern extends string. Then our function is going to return a path, and the path needs to know about the params. So we'll add a helper type that's called params. That's going to take the pattern, and this is going to turn that pattern into the corresponding object type. And then the path is parameterized on that. So we'll get our syntax right, and now let's define, there's a couple orders that we could do this in. Let's start with the path type. It's going to take the params, and it's just a function that takes those as an argument and returns a string that is the generated URL, the generated path. This is just a normal string because by the time we've really generated an actual concrete path, we no longer need any type information because we're just going to throw it into an href attribute on an a tag. Let me get rid of this error by just hitting the type system with the any hammer. we don't care about the body here. The params type, this is where all the complexity here is going to live. And I'm actually going to start not by defining this, but defining another type it's going to need. So let's just totally think about this type in isolation. This type is going to take an actual path specification, a pattern, so something like our lesson pattern that we've already seen. And it's going to give us a union of literal string types that are the names of the parameters in that pattern. So something like courseId or lessonId in our case, because those are the two holes here, the two params. This looks, in most statically typed languages, this is not something you could do. It looks impossible, but it is totally doable, no code gen or anything. And it's only possible because of the new template literal type inference, I think I said that right, feature that came sometime in 3.x, I don't remember when. So let's start writing that type. We're going to have we'll call this param names because it gives us the names of the parameters from that pattern. It's going to take a pattern which is some kind of string. Incidentally, I should mention, because of the way we're defining this, this could just be string or it could be a union of a bunch of strings. Neither of those is intended usage of this, and if you do that, you will end up with a type error. It may be confusing, but if you look at the way this is used, you're probably not going to make that kind of mistake. Anyway, starting with this type definition. In fact, before we even start with this type definition, let's write a test of sorts. So we'll say if we have some x that is param names of just the string courseId with a colon, so this is a tiny little route pattern, we should be able to assign the string courseId to that. So basically we're saying it's going to chop off that colon. Now right now it's passing because any, but if we get rid of the any and put an actual type in, then we'll get something more interesting. This is going to be a three-way conditional type. It's going to use infer. It's going to have template literal type inference, template literal string type inference. I forget the correct invocation. It's going to have that thing, you know what I mean. So there are some pretty advanced types in here, but we'll start with the simple case that corresponds to this. If pattern is a string that has the shape where it starts with a colon and then has anything after that, which we'll call the param name, then this just is that param name. So we're just saying slice the colon off. And otherwise we'll get never, of course, everyone's favorite base case. And that makes this type check. Now if I mess this up, now it doesn't type check. We got a red underline here. That's lint. There we go. Courseída is not assignable to type courseId. So this was the easy case. Now we get a couple of cases that are a little bit harder. What if pattern extends? Again, it starts with a colon. Again, we have a param, but then we have a slash followed by some other stuff. We don't really care what that is. And in that case, again, we want to return the param, but we have to union it with whatever params are in here. We don't know what this is. This could be a very long string with lots of params in it. So we will recursively invoke our type, and we'll give it rest. I have a type error because colon. So if we write a test for that, let's say we have, so this would be something like courseId slash lessonId, and we'll give it, is this going to work? Yeah, that'll work. We'll make it an array type so we can make an array of courseId, lessonId. I believe that should work, yep. And if I typo lessonida, no good. Type error says not assignable to, and you can see at the bottom of my screen there, there's that union. So we are getting a union of those two things. Now the third case is the one that lets us fully generalize. So let's take our full-on string type and we'll make another test, give it that, use an array again to test a couple different cases. In fact, we just want to do really this again. And now this is a type error. Now these type errors are going to be weird because this we have a missing case here. So never, actually they're both never. I've never seen a never come up when using this in actual code, but of course right now it's halfway implemented, so it's going to get confused. The final case we need, we can guess at what it is by looking at these two closely. Both of these start with colons, but not all patterns start with colons. In fact, this pattern that we're working with doesn't start with a colon. So we need something where if there's anything else at the front, we want to just ignore it. We want to just chop that off so we can see another string that starts with a colon, and then these two can take over. So let's actually do that. It's going to be the final case. And we're going to say, no colon there. We're going to have some stuff at the beginning that we don't actually care about. This is something like slash courses slash at the beginning. We just want to get rid of that. So I'll put a underscore on it to sort of indicate that it's thrown away. And then we're going to have a slash, and then we will have our actual param. But I call this rest, not param, because there could actually be lots of stuff here. Like this corresponds, whoops, where's my cursor? There we go. This corresponds to this entire subregion of our pattern. So yeah, there's a param name here, but there's a bunch of other stuff after it. So we have a rest here and we need to recurse on it. So let's recurse on not just rest. There's one more thing. We have to reinsert the, what did I do wrong here? I didn't close my literal string, okay. We have to re-add the colon, because if you look at this, how we disassembled this string right here, we sort of took the colon out and only captured what was after the colon. So we need to put the colon back in, because that's how these two rules are gonna know that it's a param. Incidentally, the ordering here is, it has to be in exactly this order. In fact, if we do this, we're gonna get type errors, as you can see. And the reason that it has to be in exactly this order is, if there's a slash anywhere in there, then we really need to disassemble it to find out whether there are more params. And if we put this case first, then it's going to swallow that slash up and everything is going to get really confused. Now, this is, I've made this a little anticlimactic. You might have noticed that the type errors here went away. That's because this code is actually correct now. So these two strings are allowed, but if we do a lessonida, no good. Lessonida is not assignable to courseId or lessonId, so it is successfully handling all the other junk that we have in this pattern and finding only the holes, only the params. Okay, so we have one thing left. We can get the names out as a union, but what we really wanted was an object type. So let's write a type. I'll get rid of these tests. We don't need those anymore. I'll write a type. Params that takes pattern extends string, and we just need to turn that union of literal string types into an actual object type. So I'm going to say this is a mapped object type, and for each of the param names of pattern, that's not right, there we go. For each of those param names, it's a string. We only take strings. And this does mean with this path library, if you were to, you can't pass a number in, you have to two-string it, for example. I don't know whether it's technically impossible to actually put type information in here somehow, but I don't want to implement that, and I'd rather just convert everything to strings. You've got to establish some boundaries about how large your types are going to get. This thing is already real big and pretty scary. Anyway, again, kind of anticlimactic, but it started type checking, and now let's make our lesson path again. Let's actually copy it verbatim from the real thing. So we have our lesson path, and now we should be able to call it with course ID of, we don't actually care, let's say TypeScript, and lesson ID of, what was the lesson in the browser? Oh, you can't see it there. I think it's recursive types. I think that's the name that we were using. That type checks. Now, if I lesson Ida, no good. Because, let's go over here to see the full type error. Object literal may only specify known properties, but lesson Ida does not exist in that type. If we omit one of the type, parameters, then, did I write that? Yeah, I did. Then we get lesson ID is missing in type. And finally, if we provide even an extra one, that's also not allowed because object literal may only specify known properties. Now, you could play games to theoretically get around that, but again, this is designed to be used in this way. You're just directly passing those patterns in. Now, from this point, there are a lot of places we could go. Obviously, we could actually implement the body of the function, but it's going to be, I mean, you can probably guess what this looks like. It's going to be something like you're going to split that pattern on the slashes, and then you're going to map over them and do something, and then at the end, you're going to join them together with a slash again, and, you know, it's just JavaScript. The interesting thing here is the TypeScript stuff, at least in my opinion. Now, this is used in production in execute program. We've been using this in production for 6 months or so. Before that, for about 2 years, we had a much clunkier version because this particular language feature, I cannot use Vim today. There we go. This particular language feature, the template literal type inference, was not there until relatively recently. And as soon as I saw this announced, I was like, I know what this enables me to do. It lets me clean up my horrible path management library and make it very nice and clean like this. So it is in production in a real commercial system. It is also on NPM. The few seconds ago here will not be true when you see it, but it is static-path, which I think is a very fitting name. GitHub under my GitHub account right there. And finally, if you are interested in execute program, we do have this pretty comprehensive TypeScript course. If I scroll down, here are all the topics in there. There's quite a lot of them. And by the time you see this, there will probably be somewhere between 2 and 2.5 times as many topics, because I have to record this a month in advance. We're close to a release of a much larger set of TypeScript content, including every single type system feature we saw in this talk, conditional types, all that advanced stuff. So that is, did I talk about everything? I think I did. We built the path thing from scratch. I showed you that it's open source, static-path, talked about execute program. Hopefully some of this is useful to you, either as a nice example of sort of what all these advanced TypeScript types are actually useful for, because it's easy to find examples of, you know, it makes sure that your string doesn't get used as a number or whatever, but these kinds of things tend to usually be very large and complex, and this is a nice example because it has all these advanced features, but it's only two types, ultimately. So, thank you very much for watching, and enjoy the rest of TSConf.